Now behold, there was a man named Joseph, a council member, a good and just man. He had not consented to their decision indeed. He was from Arimathea, a city of the Jews, who himself was also waiting for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down, wrapped it in linen, and laid it in a tomb that was hewn out of the rock, where no one had ever lain before. That day was the preparation, and the Sabbath drew near. And the women who had come with him from Galilee followed after, and they observed the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and fragrant oils, and they rested on the Sabbath according to the commandment. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb, bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened, as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Then, as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words. Then they returned from the tomb and told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. And their words seemed to them like idle tales, and they did not believe them. But Peter arose and ran to the tomb, and stooping down, he saw the linen cloths lying by themselves, and he departed, marveling to himself at what had happened. I invite the choir to come forward for their anthem.
Thank you.
Please rise. You're joining in the confession and absolution as it's found in your bulletin. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin.
For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is always before me.
Against you, you only have I sinned and done this evil in your sight.
That you may be found just when you seek, and blameless when you judge.
Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me.
Behold, you desire truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden parts you will lead me to know wisdom.
Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me.
Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me by your generous spirit.
Rejoice, dear sinners, for your sins are forgiven through Christ Jesus. By raising Jesus from the dead, God declares to you that he has accepted the sacrifice Jesus made on the cross for your sins. Your debt of sin has been paid. In the name of and by the command of our risen Lord and Savior, I forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Come here today to celebrate, rejoice in the victory that our Savior has won for us through his death and through his resurrection. We are reminded that the resurrection of Jesus was prophesied already in the early pages of the Old Testament, that Jesus' resurrection was foretold, as is our resurrection as well. Our Old Testament reading for this morning is found recorded in Job 19, beginning with verse 23. Job says, "Oh, that my words were written. Oh, that they were inscribed in a book, that they were engraved on a rock with an iron pen and lead forever. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and he shall stand at last on the earth. And after my skin is destroyed, this I know, that in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another. How my heart yearns within me." This truth of the resurrection of our Savior Jesus was foretold, proclaimed, and believed by the believers of the Old Testament. It was continued to be proclaimed by the believers also of the New Testament. I invite you to rise and join in making confession of our faith with those believers who have gone before us, as they too made confession of their faith in the resurrection of Jesus and of our resurrection on the last day. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the holy Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Please rise. Grace, mercy, and peace be to each one of you in the name of our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The word of God which we're considering this morning is found recorded for us in the book of Acts, chapter 13, verses 26 through 39. We hear the words of the Apostle Peter as he preaches one of the sermons regarding the resurrection of Jesus following Jesus' ascension into heaven. Brothers, sons of the family of Abraham, and those among you who fear God, to us has been sent the message of this salvation. For those who live in Jerusalem and their rulers, because they did not recognize him nor understand the utterances of the prophets, which they are read every Sabbath, fulfilled them by condemning him. And though they found in him no guilt worthy of death, they asked Pilate to have him executed. And when they had carried out all that was written of him, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a tomb. But God raised him from the dead, and for many days he appeared to those who had come up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are now his witnesses to the people. And we bring you the good news that what God promised to the fathers, this he has fulfilled to us, their children, by raising Jesus. As also it is written in the second Psalm, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. And as for the fact that he raised him from the dead, no more to return to corruption, he has spoken in this way, I will give you the holy and sure blessings of David. Therefore, he says also in another psalm, you will not let your Holy One see corruption. For David, after he had served the purpose of God in his own generation, fell asleep and was laid with his fathers and saw corruption. But he whom God raised up did not see corruption. Let it be known to you, therefore, brothers, that through this man, forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. And by him, everyone who believes is freed from everything from which you could not be freed by the law of Moses. This is the word of our God. Please be seated. In the name of our Savior, who is risen indeed, your fellow redeemed. The text that we're considering for this Resurrection Sunday is found in an interesting place. The words of the Apostle Paul as he was journeying throughout Asia on his first missionary journey. You might remember the Apostle Paul. He didn't always have that name. Originally, he went by another name, the name of Saul. He was a Pharisee, a very devout Jew, and he persecuted Christians. He was well known for traveling throughout Judea and the region of Israel, gathering up those who professed a faith in Jesus, in his death and resurrection, threw them into jail, and even was involved in their death in many cases. Yet it was this man that the Lord brought to know personally his own resurrection. He appeared to him on a road on the way to Damascus, and Paul became a believer in Jesus as well. Paul was on his first missionary journey. He had been set apart along with Barnabas to go and to proclaim the name of Jesus to Jews who had heard about the Christ, the Messiah, but who didn't realize that it had been fulfilled in the person of Jesus of Nazareth. He was also sent to Gentiles, those who didn't know anything about Jesus or of the Messiah of the Old Testament. It was this Jesus that the Apostle Paul proclaimed. This sermon was spoken in the city of Antioch. He and Barnabas were there in that city, and he was invited by the Jews to come into the synagogue, their church, and to bring a message on one Sabbath, on a Saturday. And this was the sermon that the Apostle Paul preached. Paul, a persecutor of the church, was here now proclaiming, testifying about Jesus, about his death, and about his resurrection. He goes back into the Old Testament and shows how the Old Testament promised and prophesied what this Jesus would do, what he would accomplish, that all that was written about him was fulfilled. Now, there's something for us to consider in these words this morning as we again celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. Are these things about Jesus simply another fairy tale? Myth? Legend? If they are, then what are you doing here this morning? On the other hand, if what has been written about Jesus, which we have heard proclaimed here in the words of the Apostle Paul, is true, if it is fact that Jesus was crucified, that he was raised again on the third day, then that truth has very serious implications for us today. Not just on this day, but throughout our lives. The Apostle Paul proclaims the fact of the resurrection. He comes to proclaim the whole truth about Jesus, who he is and what he came to do. We will see Paul speak about the death and the resurrection of Jesus as being a fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecy. And we will see that he also emphasizes that the death and the resurrection of Jesus brings freedom to the sinner through the forgiveness of sins. We pray that the Holy Spirit would bless our meditation on these verses this morning and bring us to an understanding of the serious implications of the truth, the resurrection of Jesus. What do we know about Jesus? Now, a lot of people say that we know about Jesus only from the pages of the Bible, and that can't be trusted. They'll accept any other historical book that follows the dating of the Bible. But when it comes to the historical record of the Gospels, the Epistles, even the Old Testament, they're ready to throw that out. What do we know about Jesus? Well, the historical record that's found in Scripture as well as other historical records from the Jews and from the Romans of that day speak very clearly about the truth that there was a Jesus from the city of Nazareth who was condemned by Pilate, who was crucified and put to death. And while many of the secular references don't say specifically that Jesus did rise from the dead, they do proclaim that it was believed that Jesus was raised from the dead. The Apostle Paul tells us very clearly what we know about Jesus in these verses. Take a look at verse 27 of our text. Paul says, "Those who live in Jerusalem and their rulers, because they did not recognize him, that is Jesus, nor understand the utterances of the prophets, which are read every Sabbath, fulfilled them by condemning him." The Apostle Paul speaks about the fact that the Jews of Jesus' day condemned him to death. And though they found no guilt worthy of death, they asked Pilate to have him executed. The Apostle Paul also speaks not only of the condemnation of Jesus before the Jews, but the fact that he was turned over to the Romans, who was also condemned by Pilate and sentenced to crucifixion. And when they carried out all that was written of him, they took him down from the tree, which is another word for the cross, and laid him in a tomb. Paul emphasizes the condemnation, the crucifixion of Jesus, the death of Jesus there at the cross, and the fact that he was laid in a tomb on Good Friday afternoon. But Paul continues, "But God raised him from the dead, and for many days he appeared to those who had come up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem, who are now his witnesses to the people." Look at what we know about Jesus. He was condemned by the Jews. He was turned over to Pilate. He was crucified on a tree, on a cross, laid in the tomb, raised from the dead. And for 40 days, Jesus appeared to his followers, reinforcing what he had told them throughout the 3 years of his ministry, that he would suffer, that he would die, and that on the third day he would indeed rise again from the dead. What's so amazing about these verses is not simply that the Gospels and the book of Acts tell us what happened to Jesus, that the apostles of the New Testament who wrote the epistles verify the truthfulness of Jesus' death and resurrection, but even to a greater degree that this truth about Jesus was promised and prophesied hundreds of years earlier in the Old Testament. Throughout the season of Lent this year, we have been focusing on the Psalms of the Old Testament, which predicted various aspects of what Jesus would fulfill through his suffering and death. And it wasn't just the suffering and death of Jesus that was prophesied in the Old Testament. Very clearly, Psalm 22 tells us that they would pierce his hands and his feet, that he would be numbered with the transgressors, hung up as a common criminal. But it was even the resurrection of Jesus that was foretold by the prophets of the Old Testament. Here, the Apostle Paul emphasizes over and over again that what Jesus did was the fulfillment of God's promise in the Old Testament. He says that the people who condemned Jesus, they didn't understand what the prophets had written. They didn't realize that they were, by their actions, fulfilling the prophecies that God had made in the Old Testament. Paul tells us that they fulfilled the scriptures by condemning him, that they carried out all that was written about him. Imagine that. The Jews of Jesus' day, the high priest, the other priests, thought they were doing the Jews a favor by getting rid of Jesus. And those individuals who should have known the Old Testament so well should have realized that by their actions, they themselves were fulfilling Old Testament prophecy by condemning Jesus to death and having him crucified. But it wasn't just those individuals who were fulfilling Old Testament prophecy. It was God himself who was bringing all of this to completion. In verse 33, Paul tells us that it was God who had promised these things to the Father, who fulfilled to us and to their children all of these things by raising Jesus. Just as it was written in the second psalm, "To you are my son. Today I have begotten you." The Old Testament also foretold the resurrection of Jesus. In Psalm 16, the last of those psalms in our text, we're told that David wrote, "You will not let your Holy One see corruption." Paul points out that the one who wrote those words, David, 1,000 years earlier, before the time of Jesus, even though he wrote those words, he wasn't speaking of himself. Paul says, he's dead and he's in the ground. His body saw corruption. But the one that he was referring to, 1,000 years in the future, Jesus of Nazareth, the Holy One of God, he did not see corruption. His body was raised on the third day, fulfilling Old Testament prophecy. Jesus was rejected by the Jewish leaders, betrayed by his own. He was lied about, deserted by his followers, mocked by those who stood there at the cross. He was crucified for all sinners and even forsaken by God. But the truth, the whole truth of Jesus and his resurrection was foretold already in the Old Testament. It's not just the Gospels and the Epistles and the Old Testament that verify this truth. Historical records of the Jews, of the Romans, and many others verify what we know about Jesus from Scripture. And if these things are true, then it has very important consequences for us today. This truth of Jesus' death and resurrection comes with great implications for us. Paul lays out those implications as well. In verse 38, he says, "Let it be known to you, therefore, brothers, that through this man, that is Jesus, forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. And by him, everyone who believes is freed from everything from which you could not be freed by the law of Moses." Paul says one of the great implications of the truth of Jesus' death and resurrection is that we as sinners have been forgiven. We have the forgiveness of sins. Think back to earlier in our service. We began with a confession of our own sins. That we were brought forth in iniquity. In sin, our mothers conceived us. That we have sinned against God. That we have deserved His judgment. And it was that judgment of God which we deserved that Jesus took upon Himself when He suffered the agony of the cross and was forsaken by God in our place. We have sinned against God. And it was because of our sin that Jesus had to come to suffer our death, to live the life that we should have lived but couldn't. He did all of that in our place. He says, through this man, forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. As human beings, we don't like to talk about sin. We don't like to be accused of sin, although we sure feel comfortable accusing others of sin. And yet, deep down, we have that guilt, that burden that we feel, recognizing that we have sinned against God, even if we don't want to admit it. When we are burdened by that guilt, by the weight of our sin before a just and a holy God, Paul points us to Jesus. He points us to the cross of Jesus, through whom we have forgiveness for our sins. No matter how great our sin might be, Jesus has paid that debt. He has set us free. It's that freedom that Paul also speaks about. He says, by him, everyone who believes is freed from everything from which you could not be freed by the law of Moses. See, that forgiveness of sins brings great freedom to the burdened conscience, to the sinner. We have been set free. Free from the curse of sin. Free from the threat of death. Free from the power of the devil. We have been set free. He says, through this man, forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you, and by him, everyone who believes is freed. Freed from everything which you could not be freed by the law of Moses. You see, the law of Moses was all about obedience. It was all about fulfilling what God had required. And that's what we couldn't do. We couldn't obey those laws of God which He set out for us. We could try, but we couldn't succeed. James says that the one who stumbles in just one point of God's law is guilty of it all. It only takes one mistake to be guilty before God. And that burden of sin and its threat has been released. We have been set free through believing in Jesus, who took that sin, our sin, upon himself, that we might be set free. It's not by our obedience. We aren't capable of obeying that law of God perfectly as he demanded. Rather, it's about the obedience of Jesus. Because Jesus did obey the law of his Father perfectly. in our place. He became our perfect substitute under the law of God. Not just our death, but he also lived our life before God. That forgiveness of sins and freedom which Paul proclaims to us has very serious implications for us. Yes, we have received the forgiveness of all our sins. We have been set free from the curse, from death, from the power of the devil. What are you going to do with that truth? Can we, who have come to know the truth, the whole truth of Jesus, and what he has done for us, as Paul says, continue in sin, continue in our old ways of life? Are we simply to leave church this morning and forget what Jesus has done for us? The truth about his death and his resurrection for you and for me? Should we simply neglect it, set it on the back burner, and really not be concerned about it? Or does this truth of Jesus, the whole truth of his death and resurrection, does it carry over into our daily lives as we leave his house here today? On the day that the Apostle Paul preached this sermon, when they heard this sermon, we're told that the following Sabbath, they invited him back again, and the whole city gathered to hear what the Apostle Paul would proclaim about this Jesus. To hear this whole truth about Jesus, who he is, what he had come to do. In our text, Paul says in that middle psalm, the reference in the Old Testament, the promise, I will give you the holy and sure blessings of David. It's a quote from Isaiah 55 in the Old Testament. In those verses of Isaiah 55, Isaiah invites you and me. Everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. And you who have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why do you spend your money on what is not bread and your wages for what does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good and delight yourself in abundance. Listen that you may live. And I will make an everlasting covenant with you according to the faithful mercies shown to David. Our Savior invites us to heed, to hear, to eat upon the feast that he has laid before us through the truth of his word, through the whole truth about what Jesus has done for us. Come, come to the waters, drink, and live. May this risen Savior, who has died and who has been raised again to assure us that we too will live with him in eternity, may he comfort you in that truth through the forgiveness of sins and through freedom from the curse of your sin, death, and the power of the devil. Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. Amen. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. The congregation may be seated. We'll continue with the singing of hymn 202. Blessed are you, O God, and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to your abundant mercy have given to us new birth into a new and living hope through the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. You have transformed the night of doubt and sorrow into the new and the eternal day of joy and gladness by rolling the stone of the tomb of the door away. You have brought life and immortality to light through the glad tidings and the good news that Christ is truly risen, that death has no power over him. You have sent unto all who live in this world of darkness the joyful hope of an inheritance incorruptible and full of glory. O Lord, we thank and praise you that through Christ you have taken away from us the sting of death, that you have given to us victory over the grave. Fill each of us who are gathered here this morning and our hearts with the joy of the resurrection. Grant unto your church and people everywhere the power of an endless life, that they may show forth your praises both here and in eternity. Bestow your grace upon our homes. Bless them with Easter's comfort, hope. Send forth the conquering banner of Christ's victory throughout the world, that people the world over may join the whole host of heaven in these songs of triumph. O Lord, we ask that you would guard us by your power, that we may be kept in this true faith. Wipe away all tears from our eyes. In every adversity and trial, preserve us, so that we will always receive the blessings of Christ's ransom and the fruits of his resurrection. In this promise which we have in Easter, take from us all the fear of death. Direct our hearts and minds to this promise, that in Christ our frail, lowly bodies will be renewed and glorified like unto his. And when you call us to our heavenly rest, may we sleep peacefully in Jesus, awaiting the sound of the trumpet when those who die in faith will rise to eternal glory. We ask all of this in the name of our risen and ever-living Lord, in whose name we also join to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Go with the comfort and the peace of our resurrected Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.